With pranams at the lotus feet of Bhagwan, dear brothers and sisters, to the extent I remember, we covered the whole of the month of November 2002. Thereafter, we started referring to back numbers and we completed the month of June and just started July. And we completed one episode of July. That's what I think. Now we shall go thereafter. Well, you know, during this Guru Purnima, all of us noticed a sort of swelling on this side of Swami. Most of you must have noticed. And he gave an explanation in one of his discourses towards the end. That swelling was so bad, very red in color, and we didn't know how he was managing. And about this, we asked Bhagwan, what is this? Why is it? What is it that we can learn out of this experience? What is it that we can learn? It is so painful to watch how he is able to bear. Bhagwan said, any doctor will tell you that the pain is excruciating pain, terrible pain. It will last for 21 days. And if it is more serious, it will affect the brain also. That is the severity are the problem that he had there. And we are not able to watch it. Bhagwan, in spite of that swelling and terrible pain, he gave 4 to 5 discourses. How is it possible? I know, at one time he could not open the mouth. He could not open it in full. It was just there. He could not open both of his jaws. He could not eat. That was the point. Then, Bhagavan, why don't you cure yourself from the pain and the swelling? Why don't you cure yourself? Bhagavan gave this answer. I will never cure myself. I will cure your problems. I don't cure any of my problems. But in response to your prayers, in response to your wish, in response to your yearning, I get myself cured. Not until then. That's what Bhagavan has said. Then don't you feel the pain, Swami? Is it not painful to you? See Bhagavan's answer, very important. I don't consider myself as the body. I am not this body. So, any swelling, any complaint of this body will never be taken seriously by me. It is no source of pain to me. Because I don't identify myself with this body. Am I clear? I am not the body. So, I don't feel the pain at all. That's what Bhagwan has said. Here, I wish to bring to your attention one or two points mentioned in Bhagavad Gita. In Bhagavad Gita, it is clearly said, God is blemishless. God has no attributes, no pain whatsoever. Though God is in the body, body is not in God. All attributes function, all attributes operate because of God in them, but these attributes are not in Him. This is what is said in Bhagavad Gita. and Bhagwan, really, how he carried the day schedule, how he moved about the whole of the auditorium, how he was talking to all the delegates who attended the conference, was a matter of surprise. We could not believe what is happening, how he is moving without taking any food, how he is talking. That is the secret of his divinity. Thereafter, I have got a point to let you know. After a couple of days, there was no more of swelling. Everything perfect. Somehow I picked up some courage. Swami, are you okay now? I don't notice any swelling. Very good, Swami. We are happy. You know what Baba said? Anil Kumar, look here. A small swelling slowly increased to the size of orange fruit. So big, slowly it increased. And the pain also increased. But as it subsided, as it is totally gone, you don't see even a mark today. Whenever there is any boil, whenever there is any cut, after the cure, you will be left with a mark. Though such a big swelling, totally gone, cured, there is no trace of its presence thereafter. That's what Bhagwan has explained. This is divinity. This is divinity. And all of us were taken by surprise when Bhagwan explained. The lesson is this. Badha, B-A-D-H-A, Sanskrit word. Pain is Bodha, B-O-D-H-A, teaching. Badha, B-A-D-H-A, pain is Bodha, B-O-D-H-A, a teaching. God suffers to teach us. God's apparent external pain is also a chance to communicate to the devotees a lesson to learn. That is what is underlying secret behind this suffering. Then, it was after a couple of days in the month of July, an elderly person came to Bhagwan. He's a very, very important person, and I don't need to mention his name. The message is important. He crossed 83. And he said, Swami, bless me. I crossed 83. I want to go to my native place. Please bless me, he said. Swami blessed him, presented him new clothes, including stitching charges. And he gave his wife new sari. And went on speaking about him. Then after some time, on the same day, another man said, Swami, I'll be completing my 60th birthday. Oh, I see. He's also a very important person. Of course, we're all very important. But that very important person happened to be there that day. We important persons were not there on that day. Other days we are available. So this person says, Swami, I completed 60 years and my birthday falls next week. He's quite elegant and active and well-dressed. Not that old as to leave. Quite all right. Swami said, get it. He presented him pakka. Chocolate color suit and gave him stitching charges for the suit. 3,000 rupees. Oh yes. And then gave him pakka new shirt also to wear. Take it, he said. And I took the chance, I said, Swami, my 60th birthday is also coming. Then he said, oh, still time, don't worry, still time. And it is in this context, Bhagavan made a statement which will be of interest to all of you. He said, here is a man who says that he crossed 83. Here is a man who says that he completed 60 years. But I tell you all, no one knows my age. No one knows my age. Bhagavan did not comment further on this statement. But I started reflecting on what he said earlier. In one of the poems he said, God has neither beginning nor an end, neither birth nor death. He is non-dual. God is existence. There is nothing like appearance and disappearance. So, when Baba says, no one knows my age, meaning he is infinite. And the so-called November 23rd is the age of the body, not of his divinity. That is one explanation. The second explanation is, this age may be 77. In the previous incarnation as Shirdi, earlier as Krishna, earlier as Rama, who can say that? Because he has been changing from time to time, from age to age, in response to prayers for a designed, stipulated program of establishing peace, love, truth, righteousness. So, we cannot say his age, because in this form, in this body you can say. But he takes forms different from time to time. Therefore, Bhagavan is very correct when he said, no one knows my actual date of birth, because he was never born. Further, I can also say, Bhagavan is never born, nor would ever leave us. Instead, we can put it this way, that he is a cosmic visitor. He is here as a visitor, with neither the beginning nor an end. That is the indirect way of communicating his divinity to all of us that evening. Then, another day in the afternoon, it so happened he started reading letters in front of us. He opened one envelope and took out the letter. There, a boy has written two lines on a long white paper. Only two lines on the top. The rest of it is blank. What did Baba say? He tore it there and gave that remaining white paper to a boy. You use it. I don't want you to waste even white paper. I don't want you to waste. And further Baba said, don't waste food. Food is God. Don't waste time. Time waste is life waste. Time is God. Don't waste energy. Don't waste water. Don't waste money. Waste of money is evil. It is in this context he taught these teachings to our boys who assembled there. I recall one time Bhagavan visiting the hostel. He got them from the car, immediately said, hey, come here. In the third floor, one fellow has not closed the tap there in the bathroom. You go and close the tap. He said, after use, you should close the tap. You should not keep the tap open and waste water. That's what Bhagavan said. And you also must have noticed when he calls you for an interview, Bhagavan gets into the interview room first, and as you all go and sit, he himself will switch on the fan. He himself will put on the switch, and the moment you leave, he will put it off. Why? Don't waste energy. Don't waste electricity. It is a kind of finest example for all of us to learn from his own life. That's why Bhagavan has every authority to say, my life is my message. My life is my message. As it doesn't waste anything, we are also supposed not to waste anything. Then, the same month, July, on some other day, Bhagavan somehow started talking about the orphanage center, you know, about 61 orphans are adopted by Bhagavan. He is taking care of them. He is providing them food and clothes, the shelter, and also educational facility to those boys there. And then Bhagavan deposited ₹1 lakh in the name of every child and deposited there in the bank, fixed deposit, so that after completing their studies, the amount deposited there, along with the interest, compound interest accrued, will be helpful to them to carry out their living, to support themselves. And on the very day of their arrival here, you should see, it's a sight for God, I tell you. He gave them good suitcases to every boy. Beautiful suitcases. Suitcase full of clothes, glass, plate, mirror, paste, brush, all underwear, what all they need, just kept in the suitcase, and he gave one suitcase to those boys. And these boys, they open the suitcase, count the number, close the suitcase, open the suitcase, they are enjoying. By going round the round buildings on the evening walk, I peeped through the window and noticed the boys feeling extremely happy watching the suitcases, clothes presented by Bhagavan. My temperament is to share with Swami whatever I see. I told Swami, boys are very much excited. Why? You seem to be excited. Why are you? Yes, Swami, I am excited, yes. Why? Because seeing the boys who are excited, I am excited naturally. He said, what happened? Swami, they are opening the suitcases, checking their dresses, each one showing the other person, suitcases of different colors, beautiful suitcases. And then Bhagavan, he said, hey, 3 pairs of clothes on the day of their coming here, I gave them 3 pairs. 3 pairs? I think, Swami, not necessary. Why? Very necessary. How, Swami? 1 pair to wear at home. 1 pair to wear for Nagar Sankirtan and Bhajans. 1 pair to go to school. To school, 3 types. Oh, Swami, very good. Because I want Swami to explain further. Excellent, Swami. And then Bhagavan said, it seems 2 crores of money is spent for this expenditure, for this costly expenditure, for this project, to begin with, including the deposit amount. Swami, is that on a large scale? Large scale? Yes, it is very necessary. Very necessary. And he made a statement, very important for everybody. Whatever I say, I do. Whatever I do, I say. whatever I do, whatever I say, are just one and the same. I don't say one thing and do different thing. I don't do one thing and say different thing. No. Whatever I say and do are exactly same. Full of truth. That is my way of life, Bhagavan, he said. It is very necessary for all of us to learn that, so that there will be harmony or unity of thought, word and deed. And after a couple of days, I saw Bhagavan distributing saris to few ladies and slowly walked towards us. And I saw Bhagavan talking to few gentlemen there. And naturally I am curious to know who they are, naturally. But I don't dare enough to ask, who are they, Swami, why have you gone? I am not supposed to ask. But watching my face, which is a question mark face, Bhagavan himself started explaining what it is. He said, you know, ladies there, have you seen? I cannot say I have seen because I have come here to see ladies. I cannot say I have not seen because I saw. So I simply smiled. Then he said, there are lady doctors. These are the doctors, men on this side. I distributed them clothes. You know, the doctor, postgraduate degrees. Surgeons, physicians, topmost doctors. Now it is time for me to elicit more information from Bhagavan. Swami, where do they come from? Now, comfortable question. Nothing to do with lady doctors or anything like that. Quite a convenient question, which would not embarrass Swami. Where do they come from? They are from Madras. Oh, Swami, Madras. I see many doctors, oh Swami. Many? 300 doctors have come from Madras. Oh, 300? Yes, 300 are here. Oh Swami, why are they here? Why are they here? Oh, they came on tour. Excursion? Teaching, not excursion. No. They started visiting villages all the way, organized medical camps all along, and reached this place, finally, for Swami's blessings. They came here for Swami's blessings. After doing service in different villages, organizing medical camps at different places. Oh, Swami, great. Oh, I see. I thought just a weekend visit. No. It's not entertainment, no. Oh, I see. And Swami, anything? Ah, yes. What? All of them can sing bhajans, you know that? Why some, I don't know. Where did they sing? Doctor, where does he sing? Not in the theater. Doctors are singing. Hey, no. They sing bhajans. Morning medical camp, evening bhajans. Oh, I see, Swami. They do it also. And then further, some of the doctors can chant Veda also. Veda chanting. Doctors, Veda? Yes, they can do it. Then Swami, he must have understood. This fellow does not seem to believe what all that is said. Because we cannot hide anything from Swami. Immediately Swami called one doctor from lady's side. Her name is Mrs. Hemadri or some other, I don't remember her name. She came. She wrote a book also. She came. How many of you have come? 300, Swami. What have you done? Medical camp. Where? In several villages. All that he said to me, got it verified there, as if in a police station or in a court. And he made her say all that. Oh, only medical camps? No, Swami, we organize bhajans also. Bhajans also? And started looking at me. Sarcastically. See that. All of you see. And Swami, some of them know Veda chanting also. Oh, Veda? So, it is then Bhagwan said, in these days, particularly for doctors, money is God. Money is God, doctors, particularly. And for them to sacrifice, to organize medical camps, to sing bhajans for everybody is just possible only in such a Sai organization. Only Sai devotees only will be able to do that. Nobody will be able to do that. That's what Bhagavan has said. Therefore, this is the best example for everybody to emulate and to learn in our own individual way. Then, in the month of August, ...2002... I happened to go to the super speciality hospital for checkup. Doctor said, Anil Kumar, better you have a checkup. I had some pain, a gout problem, they say, G-O-U-T, gout problem, where the joints pain. Doctor said, you come and get yourself examined in super speciality hospital in the month of August. From this episode, we start collecting what all that had happened in the month of December. Well, I went to the hospital and visited it for the first time, this hospital. I had never been there before. Of course, I was there on the day of inauguration, along with Swami, for translation purpose. Why I am afraid of hospitals? I am afraid of doctors. I cannot see the doctor because I may be reminded of my diseases, which are non-existent. I cannot see the patient's suffering. So why unnecessarily self-torture? So I don't go to the hospital usually. Because they went, they asked me to go for a checkup, I had to go. Well, then in the evening, Bhagavan asked, why did you go? Where, Swami? Hey, where did you go? Swami, I went to the college. I'm still in service. No, after. Because I had class in the first hour. After that, I went to the hospital. So, Swami asked, after. Swami, I went to the hospital. Then he said, what happened? Now I thought, it is time for me to explain Bhagavan how beautiful the hospital is. Swami, my condition is not that bad as to cry right from the entrance. I'm quite fine. Only some problem in the toe, some pain. But doctors wanted me to get checked up, so I came. And the building and the dome and the lawns and the flowers, the gardens, it doesn't look like a hospital. Is not a hospital, then what is it? He said, it is Buckingham Palace. I felt as if I am going to attend wedding reception. It's so beautiful. Because I find the patients and the attendants all with smiling faces. I didn't find any long, serious face expressive of critical condition of the patient. All are fine. All are laughing. So I thought that I am attending wedding ceremony almost, not a hospital. And then I saw there idol of Lord Vigneshwara, Vinayaka. Well, I did my namaskar. Such a beautiful Vinayaka inside, just where the dome is there, the like of which I have not seen till today, Swami, anywhere. Why? He said, because its size so big, its color so dark, is made up of granite. polished, shining, such a beautiful idol, Swami. And then I said, there, inside the dome, at the center, I find huge pictures of Swami, very beautiful, 6 feet, 8 feet, beautiful collection, wonderful pictures of Swami. Oh, is it the first time you have gone? Yes, Swami, first time. I pray it should be last time also. Because I don't want to go there. Then he laughed. And then he said, all right, where did you go? Swami, I went on walking along the corridors. The flooring, the floor, the color of the flooring, the matching color of the wall, beautiful. And the flooring is so shining that I can see my own image there. It is so clean that even if the milk spills out of the glass, we can collect it and pour it again and drink it. It's so good. You like it? But Lord is so happy because it is His own creation. It is His own, He is happy. You liked it? Yes, Swami. Not only that, I don't find any spot on the wall. The walls are so clean. The flooring is so clean. I was very happy. Not even a grass blade. Not even a paper. It is so clean, Swami. And then I said, Swami, I also saw black boards in front of every doctor's and in front of doctor's room, in front of theatres, with letters written in gold color. A beautiful matching indeed. Flooring ash color. The wall biscuit color. The board black color. Letters in gold color. Hospital is colorful. So it is so nice, Swami. Oh, I see you liked it. All right. What did you do there? Let me know. You are simply washing the flooring there? No, Swami. I went to the biochemistry lab. What did you do there? I got my blood examined. Because they said blood test must be done. Oh, I see. What happened there? Usually, biochemistry lab will be full of bad smells. Tincture, Dettol, horrible stuff. You feel really sick in the laboratory. Though we are healthy, we'll certainly fall sick in the laboratory. That is the kind of biochemistry lab everywhere. Oh, I see. How is this lab? Swami was asking me. This lab didn't smell at all. Oh, I see. I didn't see any bandage left on the ground. And I didn't see anybody crying. And the staff nurse, trained nurse, just taking sample blood nicely, neatly. I was very much afraid because she wanted to put my hand like that and lady needle there. But she put it in such a soft way, engaging me in conversation. How are you, sir? We hear your talk nicely. Zap, and got it. By the time I gave the reply, blood is out, if not the answer. So nicely they did it, Swami. It is a dedicated service. I am very happy about it. And then outside this biochemistry lab, I saw number of people sitting on the benches there. Number of people. Because they should be in the line, in queue, and get themselves tested there. But I could not understand who is a patient and who is an attendant. Because attendant and patient are equally joyful, are equally smiling. How to distinguish? So your hospital is a place of smiles, comfort and health. You liked it? Very much, Swami, I said it. And then where did you go? Swami, I went to the bone specialist. Why? Because of a problem with my toe. And the doctor spoke to me so nicely. that I forgot to mention my problem. Then you have to say, what brought you here? Swami, it won't happen anywhere. Later I came to know the heart section, the eye department, they are equally efficient. That people are committed and dedicated to serve you. And I also know the students of Sri Sathya Institute of BioLearning, boys and girls working in the super specialty hospital with very high degrees, achievements, gold medals, they are just working there as an act of service because of their devotion to you. It will not happen anywhere. I was so happy, Swami. And not only that, Bhagavan, I want to tell you another thing. I want to get my blood pressure checked up, that's all. Though it's quite all right. Why not I get it done instead of being asked to do so later, which I never want to do. So what to do? Immediately I went to one very big hall where heart patients are admitted. That very big hall with a gray, the dark blue flooring color, dark blue, white wall, right, very big one. Swami, I'm so happy to see that very big hall with after all 4 beds, that's all. From the Indian standards, many hospitals will make that big hall into at least 6 or 10 rooms with 2 patients in each. Here is Bhagwan, who accommodated only 4 beds there in a very big hall, which will divide into 6 to 8 rooms by other people outside, commercial hospitals. So you like that also, very much, Swami. Then I should tell you, Swami, one thing that had happened. What? I spoke to one nurse. You spoke, nurse? Have you gone there to talk to everybody? No. I want to know about your hospital. I called one nurse and said, look here, sister, where were you before coming here? She said, sir, I was in Bangalore before I came here. Huh? Then what did you ask? Swami said. Second question I put to her, Swami, why did you leave that job and come here? Why have you left Bangalore? Why are you here? Here I am serving Swami directly. I am serving Swami directly. A great opportunity of service. And so I am here. My third question to her is this. What is the difference between your work there in Bangalore and your work here in Prachantanaya? Swami, Swami, she said, the work is same in both the places. The seriousness of work, the quality of work is very much same in both the places. But the difference is, we don't feel tired here. We don't feel tired here at all, though we do a lot of work. We are very healthy and we are very happy. And so, though work is a tiresome, but I am not tired. And I am always energetic. That is the difference between that place and this place. And then, I went to the canteen, Swami, there in the hospital. Oh, you always believe in eating. So Swami, I believe that food is God and food must be worshipped for every 3 hours. So I went there to the canteen to eat something. There I found one elderly man of 74 years. I said, sir, why do you work here at this age? Anil Kumar, by working here, I am healthy. At home, I am sick. So I am here. Oh, I see. This is the secret of health. Oh, good. Sir, what do you do here? He said, I do three jobs. One, canteen accounts. Two, providing accommodation to the attendants of the patients. Three, maintain the records here. Oh, sir, 74 years. At the age of 40, how, at the age of 30? Well, I cannot imagine how you must have worked when you were young. How are you able to work at this age? And that man said, look here, Anil Kumar, I attend Nagar Sankirtan every day. And the energy I get by attending Nagar Sankirtan is responsible for my activity, he said. To be very honest enough, I don't attend Nagar Sankirtan. Because I have to prepare, read a lot, so much of work, writing articles, book, publication. If I attend Nagar Sankirtan, I must sleep in the classroom. My teaching may take them to sleep, but I cannot teach as I teach, you know. When that grand old man said that his energy is because of Nagar Sankirtan, it is something very interesting to note, the power of Nagar Sankirtan. In one of the rooms, I saw young lady sitting on the bed where a boy was lying there. Out of curiosity I went. Sir, what boy was trouble? Sir, wheezing problem. So I got admitted here. Then I looked at the young lady. Are you related? That lady said, sir, this boy is from our school, Sri Satya Sai Primary School. He's a teacher. I am attending on him. You attend on me? Yes. Four of us teachers, we work by turns here, attending on the boy. Bhagavan, nowhere teacher attends on a sick boy. Nowhere, impossible. Out of love. And the boy was smiling, though he is sick. Love. That's what we find in Sri Satyai Education Institution. The teacher could conduct herself more than the mother of the child. His own mother wouldn't have served him as much as this teacher, which is really great. Later, few girls came to me. Sir, we are from Anantapur campus. We are working here in this hospital. I say, good. What do you do on Sunday? Sunday is holiday. What do you do? I thought they would come to Mandir for bhajan. But those girls said, no sir, there is a small village behind super speciality hospital called Bidu Palli. Bidu Palli is the name of the village behind the hospital. These girls go there serving the village, organize Balavikas classes, teach them Veda, teach them bhajans. That's what service they do on Sunday. While having hectic activity for 6 days, in a week, 7th day, social service. Do you believe it? Will it happen anywhere? That is something very special in Sri Satyai Education Institutions. Then Bhagavan, I said to myself, you are unparalleled, unequaled. None can equal you. You alone can do it. To inspire everybody, to prompt everybody, to such an extent, as to take to service, even on a holiday, even at a time when they feel like relaxing, you are God, there's no doubt about it. None would be able to do that. That's what I said to myself and shared the same thought with Bhagavan also. Then again in the same month of August, it so happened one evening, Swami was sitting on the chair as you see there. And suddenly, he asked one boy, get the letter. That boy started running and walked very close to me, that he touched me almost. Then Bhagavan was very serious. He said, you boys, you should learn manners. When your teachers are seated there, can you jump over them? Can you walk like that, touching them? You should not do that. Our institution is a modern institution. You should respect your teachers. You should respect your elders. You should not sit along with them. You should take next seat. This is not the way. And then, important statement is this. He said, boys, you can touch me, you can pull me, you can be very close to me, because I belong to you, you are mine. But you cannot behave with two teachers like that. And here, it's a beautiful statement of Bhagavan, where he has claimed students as his property. You can push me, you can touch me. But towards elders and respects in the, and teachers in the society, you should show proper respect to others. And while coming for darshan, you should come in a line. You should be so slow. You should not push others. And then looked at me seriously and said, you don't tell these things to boys. You are responsible. Swami, yes, I am responsible. That you should tell them how to be proper. You teachers don't tell. Parents don't tell. How do you expect them to learn? Because you are here to tell, Swami. That's what I said to myself. Because those things that the parents and the teachers don't teach, Bhagavan takes it upon himself as his duty to tell them. Manners, courtesy, behavior, that's really, shocking to learn that day. And then, how about the society? Students are competing to get ranks. Students are competing with each other for marks, but they don't compete with each other for good conduct, for good behavior, to be good and to be ideal. Three such education institutions. Teach them the spirit of idealism, the way how to conduct oneself in society. In that way, these institutions are unique. Then on some other day, in the month of August, on one of the fine evenings, Swami looked at the boys. Hey boys, you're all MBA boys, right? He said. They're students of MBA class, Master of Business Administration. You're all MBA boys, right? Yes, Swami. Oh, I see. And then he said, what is the lesson taught to you this morning in the classroom? What is it that is taught to you? The boy said, Swami, we had a very good lecture on marketing. Marketing. And Swami said, marketing. Very good. What is your specialization? Marketing, Swami. Oh, I see. Your specialization? Marketing, Swami. Oh, I see. Then, what is marketing? Tell me. What is marketing? Though they are specializing marketing, they could not tell what marketing is. But one fellow said, Swami, marketing is a place where goods are sold. Baba said, you are wrong. And then another fellow said, marketing has three: production, distribution, and sales. These three constitute marketing. Swami said, you are wrong. And Baba said, see that. How he spiritualizes the mundane worldly subject. Marketing is a worldly subject of the MBA program, but he made it spiritual. He divinized it. How? He said like this. The whole life is marketing. Eating, drinking, breathing, everything is marketing. Swami, marketing, yes. You breathe oxygen, release carbon dioxide. It is marketing. Yeah. So in every activity of your life, nutrition, excretion, loading, unloading, there is marketing going on in the human body. And then I said, Swami, there is some talk outside. I am not student of marketing or MBA. I am student of botany. But I think it is my business to keep Swami there for some more time on the chair. Keep him engaged. So that many will have darshan and I will have so much of materials to share with devotees. Whether it is my subject or not, my object is to interfere and prolong the dialogue. So what I said was, Swami, people say that marketing is not proceeding along the sound lines today. Would you please tell us why? Why marketing is not proceeding in a healthy way? Why? Bhagavan said, today marketing is not proper. Something wrong there. Because there are more of imports than exports. We go on importing, but there is less of exporting. This is a mistake in the marketing. Further he said, people go by fashion, fashion. Fashions, external fashions, they don't think of the reality. Then I said, Swami, is fashion a wrong thing? Yes, I want to look fashionable. Why not? I like good fashion, why not? Good dress and all that. Is fashion anything wrong about it? He said, there is nothing wrong if you are after some fashion. But in trying to look fashionable, if you imitate others, that is totally wrong. Imitation is wrong. Say, for example, jean pants. People wear jeans abroad in US and all that. Because jeans there, if I wear jeans here, the skin will come out because it's a hot place. It's a hot place. Jeans won't fit this climate. The fellows go on imitating. That's why jeans are very costly. Each it's pant, 300 rupees or 400? 900 rupees jeans pant. See that these boys also wear jeans. 900 rupees, see that? Why? America, United States of America, jeans, why not? I wear. So imitation. Therefore, this is how things have been going on, as Bhagavan has said. And suddenly, he looked at one boy and said, boy, what are you studying? He said, Swami, I'm MBA student. Oh, I see. Before that, what did you do? Swami, I completed engineering. Oh, I see. Then I was just wondering, why should he ask so many details? Why? Swami said, 4-year course engineering? Yes, Swami said. No. You took 5.5 years to complete engineering because you failed. Nobody knew until Swami said to everybody. We are all thinking there is an engineer and doing is that. Then he said, of course, nothing wrong about it. Only to let you know that I know. Only to let you know I know. And then he said, no, it's not your mistake. The examination, they were postponed periodically every time. And they conducted examination at a time when you are not prepared. So, it's not your fault. It's a mistake of the university for postponing the exams like that. That's how he defended the boy. And then, in the month of August, sometime later, very interesting thing has come into the discussion that day. He was inquiring, what's your name? What's your name? And they were telling, my name is Dr. Akhil Abhinav. They were all telling their names. And then Baba said, "Are boys, about names I will tell you a small story. Your name should not be confusing. Your name should be straight, so that others will not be confused." I was wondering, name confusing? Can name confuse people? Yes. Then Bhagavan said one story. It seems newly married couple started their life in a city. One day, postman delivered a letter. And the husband picked up that letter. That letter is actually for his wife. But the husband opened the letter. Censor board. He read that letter. What are the contents? "I love you very much. We were together for a long time. I cannot forget our days. I am waiting when those days would return. A day should come when we should dine together. We were never away from each other all these years. I am coming to see you very soon." My wife, somebody to love her more than I love her? He is very much wonder struck. And there at the bottom, he was looking at the signature. The signature was Lakshmi Narayan. Lakshmi Narayan. Lakshmi is the name of a girl. But this fellow did not see Lakshmi properly. Narayan is the name of the man. "Oh, my wife has an affair with Narayana. I see. Let me be careful. Let me see." Then he was waiting for Monday when that Lakshmi Narayan would come here. And then he's waiting at the door with a stick to beat both Lakshmi Narayan and also his wife together at the same time. Like bhajan third column. To finish them off. Now, he was hiding behind the door. One person came into the house and that person was talking with his wife. And this fellow overheard the conversation. "Hey Lakshmi, when did you come?" "Only now. We're glad to see you. I wrote a letter, did you not receive?" "No, because the letter is already collected by the husband." "Oh, I didn't know that. Oh, I wrote you. You must have received my letter. How are you?" "I see. I'm so glad that you got married. I want to see how you are." "Oh, I see. That's me. You also got married?" "Yes, I too got married. My husband's name is Narayana." "So, Lakshmi Narayan." Then this fellow could understand. Lakshmi Narayan. Narayan is husband's name. Lakshmi is her name. So, this fellow mistook that a man is coming, having an affair with his wife. So Swami said this story and told everybody, be careful while having a name, so that you don't get into trouble when once you get married. Let not your wife misunderstand you. That's what he said. You follow the story? Am I clear, please? That's what he said that day. Then, in the month of August, some other thing had happened. Sir, when do you want me to stop? Can I go on? Yes. Since Bhagavan gave me some time, some chance to talk as he does every day because of his infinite mercy, not necessarily my deservedness, because I am very open about it, I chose to put some questions. Swami, Ramana Maharshi, have you heard of his name? Ramana Maharshi made a mention of sound in silence. sound in silence. Nishabda Brahmamu. Nishabdamuloni Shabda Brahmamu. Nishabda, silence. Shabda Brahma, sound. Listen to the sound of the silence. That's what he said, Swami. Is it possible? And then, Ramana Maharishi also says, the best way of communication is silence. Best way of communication is silence. Mauna, silence. I don't understand, Swami. And the whole message of Ramana Maharishi is only this. Make an inquiry, thorough inquiry, on this question. Apply to yourself. Put to yourself this question. Who am I? Who am I? That is the essence of the teachings of Ramana Maharishi. I don't understand anything, Swami. Please let me know. Bhagavan said, very beautiful explanation. My friends, I don't know, since most of you do not follow Telugu, you are not in a position to attend my Saturday talks. Every Saturday I give a talk at 7:30 in Telugu. I have been speaking on Bhagavan Ramana and Bhagavan Sri Satya Baba, teachings and parallels. After this, someday we'll take up that later, God willing. God willing, we'll take up that after we complete this project. Everything is recorded and the material is available with me. My only ambition is to share the knowledge with as many people as possible. Nothing personal. So we'll do it someday. When I have put this question, what did Baba say? In the state of silence, by the process of inquiry, what happens is the heart opens up. The heart opens up. And then you will understand who you are. Until the heart opens, not the physical heart, or cardiology, heart surgery, open heart surgery, not that, please don't mistake that way. I mean the spiritual heart. When the heart opens up, you will be knowing your true self, not till then. So, in state of silence, when the mind is withdrawn, when we are in a thoughtless state, wordless state, speechless state, in utter state of silence, then the heart opens up. You listen to the sound of Omkara from within and you'll be knowing your true self. That's what Bhagavan has said. Bhagavan also made a mention of another thing. Swami, what do I get by knowing who am I? What do you get? If I know myself, what is the advantage? What is the benefit? Because we are all from the worldly sense, we want to know what we get. I attend Nagar Sankirtan, what I get? I go and sit there, what do I get? We don't get anything. Until we stop this line of thinking, we will not get that what is expected. We will not get that what we should get. Because that is transcendental experience. That is transcendental psychological experience when we turn inward. So that is a journey. There is a travel, a higher step, which we should necessarily go to. So, Bhagavan said, by knowing yourself, I, you will be knowing everything else. When your true self is known, everything else is known. How? How? Bhagavan said, number 9 and number 1, there are two numbers here. 1 and 9, which is a big number, which is higher than the other. We all say number 9. Baba said, no. 1 is higher than 9. I am already poor in mathematics. With Swami speaking like that, I have to question my elementary mathematics. Swami, 1 is higher than 9? How is it possible? He said, look here. 1 plus 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 1 is equal to 9. There cannot be 9 without 1. So, this 1 is greater than the 9. Without 1, there is no 9. So, without 1, there are none. So, the 1, the only 1, that is your true self. So, the 1, the only 1, the real 1, the self, if that is known, the rest of the things of the world are known. That's what Bhagavan has said. What a nice interpretation it is. And then, Bhagavan made a mention, another point. In Ramayana, you must have come across a character by name Hanuman. And Bhagavan was talking about that character, Hanuman, after this, Ramana Maharishi. Then Swami started talking about Hanuman. Hanuman is known to be a very, very intelligent person, known for his intellect, known for his skills of communication. And he is the jewel in the entire epic Ramayana. And then Swami said, one should learn the art of speaking from Hanuman. When enemies ask him, who are you? He has not said, I am so and so. He said, I am the servant of Lord Rama. He is so humble, so soft and sweet in his conversation with everybody. One should know how to talk. And if you talk well, you'll get a good name. If you talk nicely, you'll have good friends. So talking is an art. Speech is a talent. That's what Bhagavan said. Further, as you talk, anudvega karam. Udvega, temper. Anudvega karam. When you talk, there should not be any temper, any anger, any emotion. No. Satyam, your word should be full of truth. Preeti, acceptable, sweet. Hitam cha, we should be for good of others. So whatever we speak should not agitate others. It should be true and it should be acceptable and it should be for the welfare of others, not to ruin others. That's what Bhagavan has said. We should not be like a snake with the two tongues. The two-tongued snake is poisonous. You should not be like that. You should be very careful as you talk. That's what Bhagavan has said. So, we'll continue next time. Okay? Thank you very much for listening to me in that attention. Thank you.